Good morning. It is my privilege to wish a happy new year to old friends in the youngest sense of the word. But I'd like to open this morning with a reading from Psalm 16. Keep me safe, O God, for in you I take refuge. I said to the Lord, you are my God. Apart from you, I have no good thing. As for the saints who are in the land, they are the glorious ones in whom is all my delight. The sorrows of those will increase who run after other gods. I will not pour out their libations of blood or take up their names on my lips. Lord, you have assigned me my portion and my cup. You have made my lot secure. The boundary lines have fallen for me in pleasant places. Surely I have a delightful inheritance. I will praise the Lord who counsels me. Even at night, my heart instructs me. I have set the Lord always before me. Because he is at my right hand, I will not be shaken. Therefore, my heart is glad and my tongue rejoices. My body also will rest secure because you will not abandon me to the grave, nor will you let your Holy One see decay. You have made known to me the path of life. You will fill me with joy in your presence, with eternal pleasures at your right hand. Let's worship together.
Please stand.
Thank you.
Good morning. I've had several opportunities in the last, couple weeks or so to scroll through some old family photos and look through some family photo albums. And my wife and I actually had the audacity to force our children to watch our wedding video. And we did that. And I started to remember things that I just hadn't thought about for years, frankly. And it made me realize that, several things actually. It made me realize that life is moving way too quickly, isn't it? And of course, my rememberer needs some major work to remember all the details and all the things that go on through life. And especially as I considered God's faithfulness, I need to adjust my rememberer in order to grow the spiritual discipline of remembering. And as I began to concentrate and remember how good God is and his faithfulness in my life throughout the course of my years, I realized that he has been constant, ever faithful to do his good work in me and by his grace through me. And the more I remembered, the more the gospel started to propel my thoughts towards hope and faith for what God would continue to do in the next days ahead for this year and beyond. Well, Jesus shared his last Passover meal with his disciples. And as he was doing that, he actually stepped into that meal, into God's story that was designed by God to help his people remember. That was the point. To remember his faithfulness for his people as he delivered them out of slavery, out of bondage, out of Egypt, and how he would fully fulfill the covenant that he had made with Abraham. As Jesus then stepped into this remembrance, he stepped in as the promised Messiah. When he picked up the bread and the cup, and he proclaimed, "This is my body, which is broken for you, and this is the cup of the new covenant in my blood." He propelled their thoughts for hope and faith forward for what he was about to do, which was go to the cross, to be the ultimate atoning sacrifice for all our sins, for all time. You see, to remember biblically is more than just an ambiguous, moment where we rehearse memories. It's more than that. It's a vibrant, powerful, and participatory active response where we can recalibrate our lives according to what is being remembered. And so this morning, let's come to the communion table together to remember the gospel and Christ's transformational work in you, and allow Jesus this morning to recalibrate your life. If you are a believer in Jesus Christ, if you have put your full trust and faith in him, you are utterly saved from sin and death to life eternal. And you are welcome here to participate in communion together and remember. So come and have your heart recalibrated by the gospel as we celebrate God's work, and we celebrate a God who is active and alive in our lives today. Come and remember what Christ has done for you on the cross, and how his body was broken and his blood was shed for you and for your sin. Come as an act of worship. Come, remember what Christ has done, and allow the gospel then to propel your thoughts, to propel your hopes and your faith forward in this new year. As the music plays here in a moment, let's prepare our hearts and our elements to share together. Let's take that time now. Let's pray together. Father God, we come before you and we ask first for your help. Help us to remember your faithfulness and your goodness to us. Help us, Lord, to look to you completely and solely as our source of strength and hope and faith. Father, we ask that you recalibrate our hearts to love more deeply, our eyes to see the world as you do, and our hands and feet to serve you more faithfully as we use our gifts that you have given to us to build up your church and to go about our lives for the sake of the gospel. Thank you, Lord, for your Son, Jesus Christ, for his body that was broken, and for his blood that was spilt, and for his death that he died for us. We ask your blessing this morning on these elements, on the bread and this cup. We ask your blessing, and we ask that these elements will stir up our memory and stir up our affections for you as you recalibrate our lives into the image of your Son, Jesus. In his name we pray. Amen. The Apostle Paul instructed the church in 1 Corinthians chapter 11 with these words. And the Lord Jesus, on the night that he was betrayed, took the bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, "This is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me." And in the same way, he also took the cup after supper, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." For as often as you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes. Amen.
Please stand. The blood. Seated. Thanks, Steve and Grant and Joel and Alice and Lisa for leading us in worship and into the presence of Jesus. I'm certainly grateful to worship with you all in this way. I always am. This morning we'll be in John chapter 12. Before we get there, you should know during the new year, you can sign up for Women's Life this year, which is starting on January 14th, either online or you can call into the church office. Or I guess you could come into the church office, too, if you're super bored. Beyond that, high school ministry will start back up January 10th. If someone you know or you yourself is a high schooler, we're going to meet back together on January 10th. And then junior high, that Wednesday, so next week, youth ministry is starting back up. And if someone you know or you yourself or your own child is a high school or junior hire and hasn't been signed up for our winter retreat to Timber Lee yet, guilt them into it or whatever tactic that you feel like you need to use. And if there's a hurdle between you and getting your child to Timber Lee, please let me know and we'd love to help you out in doing that because we want whoever is able to be able to come to that retreat. Finally, this week begins our week of prayer here at WSBC. If you go online to the church website, under the events tab, that very first week of prayer, is it behind? Yeah. January 4th through the 10th, all of the information is online. You were probably already sent a prayer guide through the email. If not, you can find that on the website, as well as all of the events that are going on this week, including both on Wednesday and Sunday night, an all-church prayer gathering right here in the sanctuary. And week of prayer is really what these next 30 or so minutes is going to be all about. I think because if we're going to say that we're going to set a week aside and consecrate it just for prayer, I mean, that's a really amazing thing, but it, not that it wouldn't be a success, but it would be a weird thing to say, hey, we're going to do this, consecrate this week just for prayer, and really just have like decently attended events and never carve out space that wasn't there before for prayer itself. And so the goal for the next 30 minutes is to kind of settle us into this commitment that we're committing to, at least by way of announcements and events, to cut out time from our weeks to do this thing that we know is far more important than anything we'll roll up our sleeves to do. And so these next 30 minutes are about this, admitting to ourselves that whether we feel it or not, can perceive it or not, that Jesus is our only good, as Psalm 16 says. And I titled my sermon, The Good Stuff, in memory of when I was in junior high. I remember junior high because I stopped doing sleepovers after junior high because I hated them. But when I was in junior high, I remember two different times at sleepovers, friends pointed to snacks and called them the good stuff. And I remember being in high school thinking about this, and I was a weird high schooler, but this was my thought. I remember realizing that I think my friends were using language in a way that was far deeper than they actually knew, because as most kids know, there is always a focal thing to a sleepover. Like, everyone's coming, the focal event is sleeping in the same room or house in a way that you don't usually with your friends, but the focal thing is something like a movie or a video game or sometimes snacks. And I think when they called snacks, like this tangible thing that you just eat, the good stuff, it was this sort of acknowledgement, a nod to the fact that this tangible thing brought us together in a way that wouldn't be fun if there wasn't a thing to bring us together. Because sleeping in the same room as someone is not fun if there's not something to do that night. And so the good stuff, the simple analog is that Jesus brings us together in this room. And if he's not here, there's no reason for us to be here. And if he is not the object of our prayers and the longing of our hearts as we do such, then we have no reason to get together and pray this week or any other time for that matter. In fact, and I tell the high schoolers and junior hires this all the time, if I don't know Jesus, there's no reason for me to know any of you. I live in Oak Park. There's no reason for me to have met any of you, except for my grandparents, because they go here. Hey, Grandma. So that's the goal of the sermon. To that end, though, let's pray and ask God for help. Father, you've gathered us here. You know why we're here and where we've come from and where we're going. You know what we worship. And you know what has a hold on our hearts. And so we ask that you would speak, make your presence clear, and draw us in with your love. Help us to worship you this morning in ways that ground our souls and substantiate our praise in the entirety of our lives. In the name of your Son, Jesus, we pray. Amen. John chapter 12, verses 1 through 8. You probably know this story. We'll read it once through and then hopefully say some faithful things about it. Six days before the Passover, Jesus therefore came to Bethany where Lazarus was, whom Jesus had raised from the dead. So they gave a dinner for him there. Martha served, and Lazarus was one of those reclining with him at table. Mary therefore took a pound of expensive ointment made from pure nard and anointed the feet of Jesus and wiped his feet with her hair. The house was filled with the fragrance of the perfume. But Judas Iscariot, one of the disciples, who was about to betray him, said, "Why was this ointment not sold for 300 denarii and given to the poor?" He said this not because he cared about the poor, but because he was a thief, and having charge of the money bag, he used to help himself to what was put into it. Jesus said, "Leave her alone so that she may keep it for the day of my burial." Or other translations will say, "She intended it for my burial. For the poor you always have with you, but you do not always have me." Let's start with Judas. Because I think he's just such a funny character. I mean, he's not funny, right? He's not. He betrayed Jesus. But there are some things that are a little bit funny about this scene. Judas handled the money bag. And John wants you to be very aware of this. And what I think is a little bit funny is that while Matthew and Mark indicate that the gripe or the complaint about the expense and lavishness of the anointment given to Jesus and not being sold to the poor came from all of the disciples, or at least just a little bit or a little group of the disciples, John instead points singularly to Judas, who is not even named, I don't think, in the other accounts. And perhaps it was because John remembered that the loudest voice, or the voice that began the collective complaint, or the voice that most articulated the gripe, was Judas's. After all, he handled the money back. He would have been thinking about this stuff anyway. Why wasn't this sold and given to the poor? Notice that the complaint issues a cold, hard jab of common sense. This is practicality garbed in morality. In this case, the pretense of serving the poor. And this was Jesus and company's typical way of doing things. He says, whatever you do to the least of these, you do it unto me. The kingdom of heaven, the mission of Jesus, the gospel has been, is, and always will be about serving those who are in need, those weary and heavy laden, in need of rest. And it's actually Judas who tries to snap the disciples and Jesus himself out of their lapse in judgment. This could have been sold for 300 denarii, that specific value not being a particular judgment of the ointment, but instead being the typical annual wage of the common laborer in that day. Meaning, Judas is very practically saying, we could have supported a family in need for an entire year, and you just poured those resources on some dude's feet. And apparently, as Matthew and Mark tell the story, Judas's grumbling lassos the other disciples into the murmur as well. And we should note this, because I think it is particularly the plain sense of Judas's argument whereby the other disciples are eased into a disdain for what I think is the coronating moment of Israel's long-awaited king, a moment that these 11 guys have been trained for 3 years to see, and they reject it before their eyes in the name of something, be careful, like excellence or doing things the right way. So at the very outset, John issues, I think, a tender warning. Be careful of groaning too quickly or joining in the complaints of this church or that political party or this group or that family. As Paul says, test the spirits. What you see that at first strikes you as incoherent or inconsistent or strange might just be a miracle before your eyes. And what you see or hear at first glance that sounds true or good or right may be false or unholy. Slow down. Be aware. Judas handled the money bag. Do you ever think about the way in which Jesus invited Judas to be one of the 12? Like, was his betrayal hardwired into his fate and identity, or did he choose it or grow into it? Amidst all of the lack of detail that John gives us in this beautiful little scene, he wants us to be very aware of one particular detail, and it comes in the form of an accusation against Judas that is levied against him only here, and that is this, that Judas used to handle the money bag, and he also helped himself to what was inside. Stealing from a band of healers, good news preachers, and demon casters. And it does not take the most vivid imagination to picture that on the journey from being installed as treasurer to the betrayal of his friend and rabbi were a multitude of instances of greed hidden beneath secrecy. Peering into the dark purse, he reached his hand to steal from the very resources that literally housed and fed his friends and alleviated the needy along the way. This little story that pictures Judas's complaint against the lavishness of the ointment is but a snapshot of a 3-year journey of a treasurer falling more and more and more in love with a money bag, all the while detaching from the mission of Jesus that he now uses to try and fuel his own idolatry. This could have been sold for 300 denarii, he said, and put into the money bag, he thought to himself. So the sobering reality is that the journey from treasurer to betrayer is not a string of crazy demon possessions or wild pagan worship sessions on the weekend that no one heard about, but a simple, discreet, easily hidden, readily justified trail of coins that led to 30 more coins. Why did Judas steal from the money bag? Simple idolatry, a love for money. Why did Judas betray the King of Heaven? A rabbi, he couldn't have ever convinced himself to believe, was not at least a great teacher and a man of God. Simple idolatry, a love for money. And the text says later on that Satan, like the big kahuna of the powers of evil and stuff, thanks, entered into Judas. Satan himself entered into Judas at Passover. So this is a few days later. Probably when Satan's entered into him, whatever that means, that's what John says. He's only doing a few more things to tie up the deal that he's probably already struck with the Sanhedrin. Satan himself. And yet, what it looks like, smells like, reads like, is that Judas's problem the entire time is not Satan, but a love for money and the choices to undergird that love. Judas had all the accountability he could have ever asked for, the best teaching in the world, and a lot of that teaching coming on account of idolatry and the dangers of money in specific, which means that me preaching this sermon and you being here this morning will do nothing on its own to cool the heat from the monster that you or I may be bowing to. The question is, what dark pouch does my hand reach into when I'm alone? What secret trail does my story leave in the dark? The questions and the answers they provide, I've begun to learn, are not about morality or issues of right and wrong. Those conversations began under the tree of knowledge of good and evil. These questions are about what we worship. They're not about my personality's dark side, something I can't shake. It's not an innocently guilty pleasure that doesn't actually degrade the substance of my soul. These questions and the answers they provide, what dark pouch my hand reaches into that I can no longer control because I love it too much, is simply about this. It is what I worship, or something I worship that I give power over to, only because I worship it, love it, want it, and refuse to say no to it. Judas handled the money bag, and eventually he fell in love with what was inside. And what strikes me here about Judas is, one, the ordinariness of the center of his issue, like a love for money, something that probably plagues the lives or has or will of most people in this room. And two, not the cruel master that money is, but how willing a slave men and women will be. Which means we should never be surprised that sin gets easier and easier as we go. Because when we worship something that did not make us, we give our hearts over to, and so lots of power to, something whose life we cannot receive. Which means when you bow down to something that is not your God, your soul is exhausted. But sitting at the table or near it is a very different soul. A soul, in this instance, feeding on the bread and cup of God's own presence, the soul-satisfying meal of divine love made available to all those who seek God in Jesus. And the question that I want to pursue just for the next few moments is Mary's praise the same as mine or as yours? I think that what Mary does here is worship, but I think she worships in a way that none of us ever will. And yet I don't want to take away from the fact that we can picture or imagine what she does and allow our souls to at least take baby steps towards her. Is the praise of Mary the same as mine or yours? The ointment that she uses to praise him is not just costly, but probably the most costly thing she owned. And women in this day did not inherit much, and so this vase or this thing of ointment that she uses to pour onto Jesus, by the way, I won't say this later, but she uses a pound of ointment. Like, have you, Abby started buying this thing called jojoba oil, and I can't spend much time on this, so if I do, you have to snap because I didn't plan to say this, but jojoba oil. Does anyone know what that is? No, maybe. It's just an oil. I don't really know. I don't know what jojoba is, so, but it comes from whatever that is. And like we put it on our face, and then we rinse it off in the shower in the water. And if I put more than 3 drops, it doesn't matter how long I rinse my face off for, I feel it when I wake up in the morning. Oil sticks with you. You probably know this more than me because I don't know anything about oil. Okay, just for context, Mary puts a pound of oil on Jesus. This is an inordinate amount of oil, which makes sense why Judas is able to say, hey, wake up. This could have been sold for a lot of money and given to the poor. Anyway, this is a costly thing, and women didn't inherit much. So this could have been a large part of the whole of maybe, or equal to the sum of all of her inheritance, her portion, as Psalm 16 says. And it was her own brother who Jesus had just raised from the dead. And as the rest of the room still steals mystified glances at the probably still dazed and pale Lazarus, who'd but 2 days ago been dead in the dark womb of a stone tomb, Mary, his own sister, has her gaze on the healer, not just the healed. And while the 12 guys who had traveled for 3 years with Jesus, cast demons in his name, healed the sick in his name, heard all of his teachings, sneer with complaints at her worship, she stays at his feet, which now receive the massive amount of costly oil she's probably spilt on his head. Feet she now wipes with her hair, for as Calvin comments, and this is a paraphrase, she judged her hands not soft enough to touch the feet of her precious king. And so she lets down her hair and worships in the posture of a slave, but a slave who adores. Could I ever praise like Mary? I read a poem last night, and one of the lines said, I have only but one heart, have mercy on me. And as I read this story over and over again, it seems like Mary has a heart at least bigger, maybe more hearts than me. Could I ever praise this vulnerably around such sneering and complaining? Could I ever praise in a way this costly? Could you? This is not the sort of worship that sparks a smile. This is not the serene bars of hymns and worship songs that make us feel light or happy. This scene is neither tender nor sweet, and it is not analogous to an uplifting devotional. I'm not trying to say we shouldn't move towards this or continue to worship in ways that we know or are common practice for us. I'm just saying there's something different, something gritty, something self-giving, soul-emptying about the way that Mary worships Jesus that I don't think I've ever seen with my eyes or heard with my ears. Because while the rest of Israel is doing what Israel had always done, it was the week before Passover and they're moving towards Jerusalem to purify themselves for the most important event in Israel's religious calendar, Mary stays back with the one who is supposed to be Israel's Passover lamb, the whole world's agent and location and destination of the brand new and final Exodus. And yet, while everyone else is trying to be ceremonial, clean to participate in Passover, the one who is supposed to fulfill it is in the house of a guy who Matthew and Mark say is called Simon the leper, as in leprosy, which means they're all ceremonially unclean, very much so. What keeps her here is a mystery. So while other Jews from Bethany went to do what faithful Jews did, Mary stayed with Jesus. Why? This couldn't have felt worshipful. And while Jesus was effectively hiding from the religious leaders who already had a price on his head, she bows at his feet as if he were already a king. Why? What kept her in Bethany was a mystery. And while the 12 guys who should have known Jesus best sneer with complaints, she draws her hair down and wipes his feet with oil. What kept her in Bethany drew her to her knees, brought her to his feet, extracted from her soul this costly praise, was nothing short of a divine mystery. The miraculous dancing of God with women and men in this world. And so while all Israel sought God elsewhere, in the safe places that they knew to seek God in, Mary stands alone at the dark precipice of faith, a brand new frontier. Every glug of oil she poured, her kneeling posture, her let down hair, her persistence beyond the disciples' mocking was an active cry to Israel's God. We need you. Our soul waits for you. Where are you? Rend the heavens, tear the skies, come down. You are our only good, our portion, our chosen cup. And with every petition, I believe her hand reached deeper and deeper into a dark that was far darker than Judas's bag. This was the mystery of God's divine love and presence in the world. And as she reached deeper and deeper with every word, with every petition, with every cry of her soul, she finally met a steady hand to guide her through the mystery. And eventually that hand guided her to lift the mop of hair that was apt to be very greasy at this point. And when she opened her eyes, they met the eyes of the hand that clung to hers. And he never let go. And neither did she. For she had just experienced in the flesh what only John could adequately pen, and the Word was made flesh and dwelt among us. Mary found faith where even the disciples mocked. So in a fashion just as discreet as Judas snatching from the money bag, Mary now peers into the depths of God's presence and finds a divine hand as tangible as cash, but warm with a life that can and will be shared with the world. This loving, gracious, steadfast hand, make no doubt about it, is the foil to Judas's pathetic lot of 30 silver pieces. But we know Judas's story. What is Mary's? In a similar way to the beginning, or to this little story where we see or it is revealed that Judas was snatching from the money bag, that helps make sense of his betrayal of Jesus for 30 pieces of silver. In Luke chapter 10, there's a story of the beginnings of Mary's story too. You probably know it well. Jesus was traveling through Israel. He finds a house that will let him in, make him a meal. The disciples are probably there somewhere listening, and so are the people who live in the house. And while Martha, the sister of Mary, is serving and clearing the table after the meal, Mary is sitting at Jesus' feet, soaking up every word. And Martha issues a pretty decent question. She says, "Lord, you know, while you're teaching, my sister is just sitting at your feet, and, well, I'm tired and there's a lot of dishes," or something like that. And Jesus says this, "Martha, Martha, you are anxious and troubled about many things, but one thing is necessary. Mary has chosen the good portion, which will not be taken away from her." While all Israel is searching for God, holy men and priests trained for rites to seek the divine, This one woman has tapped into the source of the world's own life, the center of all things. She's found Israel's God in flesh and bone and blood. And she's soaking up every word that resonates with her soul. Every story she's heard from the Torah resonates in the one who teaches just before her. Why would he make her let go? She's found the good stuff, the good portion, the focal thing, the center of all things. Why would he make her let go? And the irony of Psalm 16. You are my chosen portion, as that the one that the psalm is accredited to is King David, who, by the way, is sitting on a pretty comfortable treasury of a pretty competent Israelite army at the time. But what he says is, you're my chosen portion. They snatched me from the field. They anointed my head with oil. God put me here. Israel placed me here. But you are my chosen portion. You are the one thing I choose to never let go of. All this stuff is great, and it makes me feel a lot of joy and pleasure, but the one thing I know I can't live without, the one thing I know will last me forever, a lifetime, perhaps an eternity, is you, my chosen portion, what I choose. So while the 30 coin betrayal was made possible by, hear this, a growing love for coins and the choices to uphold that love, this world-changing lunge for faith in Mary, this gritty, soul-spilling, self-emptying praise is made possible only because a growing love for Jesus. And just as Judas tended to his idolatry by sneaking into that money bag time and time again, we can have no doubt that Mary tended to her love for Jesus, her care for her, his every word. And we can have no doubt about the fact that there are a myriad of unrecorded stories of Mary lingering at the feet of the one that she found to be later the King of Israel, the God of earth himself. Mary chose Jesus. So we may be able to name the pouches that we reach into, may be able to name the secret trails that line our stories in the dark, whether it's coins like Judas or otherwise. We may be able to name the monsters that we bow to, the vices that we most want and have learned to love, but named sins that are never left will only make us miserable. And if we do not trade our pursuits of things below for a pursuit of things above, as Paul says, then the heart that is empty and swept and confessed will only be revisited by the same demons and sins that once dwelt there. So Paul says often in his letters, seek the things that are above, not on things on earth. Why? Because you can't trade malice for a neutral state of being human. You can only trade malice for love. You cannot trade being ungrateful for just being blah. I don't know what that in between would be. You have to trade it with gratitude, with worship. So Mary doesn't enact this amazing history-making, I think, anointing because of her last name just randomly chosen by God. No. God could have inspired any of the 11 soon-to-be apostles to perform this all-important anointing of Israel's everlasting king and the world's eternal savior. Why this one random woman? because hers was a story of choosing to soak up the words of Jesus. She sat at his feet before. Why wouldn't it be her this time? Mary knew what she was about, and she made the choices to undergird the love she had for her king. She knew her inheritance was not locked up in some jar, but the resurrecting, soon-to-be-resurrected king, a king who needed an anointing, a king who was in a few days' time to be lifted up, a king who, when all others would go to anoint him, would have that divine alarm clock have him up and Adam out of the tomb. So while all Israel prepared for Passover, Mary of Bethany, a random Israelite on all other accounts, who loved God as a grateful child, performed this amazing, sacred, history-changing rite that no priest had ever trained for and no prophet ever glanced towards. And in the house of a leper on the Judean countryside, the King of Kings received a royal anointing amidst the murmurs of a still murmuring and groaning Israel through the voices of his own disciples. An anointing by a woman who sought the heart of God and found it in this flesh and blood king, a steady hand to guide her through the divine mystery of God's presence on earth. What a story. And I think to hear this story, especially before a week of prayer, and I'm not saying anything you don't know, we're not learning anything new today, but to hear this story up front, even just once, is to confront our, not just souls, but imaginations with praise so vital, faith so active, love so gritty, hope so convicted, that we perhaps may be inspired to cease seeking those earthly things that we have learned to love so much and begin to seek something from up above. This is not about morals, not about me telling you what is right or wrong. This is not about getting excited for big and flashy worship events that make our hearts beat faster. This is a story about a woman who found the heart of God because she sought it when he was far, so that she could find him when he was near. The story is about the everyday, ordinary decisions to worship God in private so that we can witness to his majesty and the good news of his coming when people are watching. This is about gritty, unsexy, ordinary worship with every decision that we make. To decide that our inheritance is not locked up in a jar at 6 a.m. and 7 a.m. and 8 a.m. and with our friends from work and with our friends from school and with our family and when we're alone. This is about worship in the most ordinary ways. Some questions, I guess. I mean, like, what practices of gratitude and worship could we trade for habits that we've not been able to previously admit had only made us bitter or ungrateful? Habits of phrase, habits of mind, habits in our relationships. But we've got to turn now to Jesus. Because again, if Jesus isn't involved in this story in some way, there's no point in us talking about this. But I think he is in this particular way. In verse 2, it says that they gave a dinner for him there. When it says him, it refers to the verse or the sentence previous. And there, both Jesus and Lazarus are mentioned. So I don't really know who exactly him is referring to, one of those two. And then it says, Martha served, and Lazarus was one of those reclining with him at table. Remember, this is significant because Lazarus was just dead. And Mary, therefore, took a pound of expensive ointment, yada, yada, yada. Mary, therefore, What is the therefore connected to? To the fact that Lazarus is there. Mary's anointing, therefore, seems like it was for the fact or in celebration of Jesus' resurrection of her brother, which would make sense. And it wouldn't just be, hey, I'm so grateful that you brought my brother back because I love my brother and I would have been sad if he was gone. It was like, I just saw you do something amazing, call dead back into life, darkness into light again. This is still an amazing anointing. And yet what Jesus accredits her anointing to is not Lazarus' resurrection, but his future burial, Jesus' death, Jesus is being lifted up, Jesus is being crowned King of the Jews. In other words, Jesus' resurrection, not Lazarus's. What I think is happening here is that Mary offers up a praise to God, who then takes her praise, the substance of her soul, the focus of her love and affection, and does with it something she never could have imagined. Something far more beautiful. Something far more earth-shattering. Which means God will take your praise, your worship, your adoration, your grit to love him above all things, and do with it something beautiful. And I just want to talk about that as we close this morning. Because the saddest part of Judas's complaint is that what he misses in front of him is a miracle. The realest thing happening in the room is that Mary is miraculously praising a God who takes what she gives him and turns it into something far bigger, far greater. And he misses it because he is listening only to his thoughts that by his idolatry have attuned his heart to listen only to his goals, only to his wants, to be motivated only by his ends. So to be the church, or if to be the church is to be a family, then to be the church is to care deeply for one another about the content, the quality, and the story, the heartbeat of one another's lives, the people sitting in the pews next to you, whether you know their names or not. This is what it means to be a family. And the shocking end to our time this morning is that this story, or that in this story, Mary illuminates that every stretch of growth in you and in me, no matter how big or small, is nothing short of a miracle. God dancing with you and me. God, the divine, dancing with women and men, teaching us to stride and sidestep and skip and lunge over trails and paths that only a short time ago would have made us break bones and lose our way and lose heart. Which means that every exiled sin or murdered vice or picked up virtue or gift with which we serve the church, put down idolatry or picked up peace of praise, every stretch of growth is God clinging to our hands as we walk by faith deeper and deeper into the dark and mysterious and exciting mystery of God's divine love. And when we see this, when I see this in you, and you see this in me, and when we can finally shush the dumb monologue that constantly tracks through our selfish heads, we can say to one another, I see him. I see him in the way that you walk, the way that you talk, the way you parent and love. I see him in the way that you care for your clients or talk about your work or your passions. I see him in the way you speak about him or your friends. I see him in the way you speak about your enemies. I see him in the way that you spend your money or time. There is no limit to the possibilities housed in the miracle that is the church when we see one another this way. Because in us, God has claimed for himself a home. Be aware. Look around. Pay attention. Let the miracles that are literally sitting all around you shake you from your sin and complacency. And when you see God's hand clasped around one man or one woman, say to her, say to him, I see him with you, guiding you, moving you along, causing you to grow. And it must be our aim to see that our jars of ointment, no matter how costly, our houses or cars or bank accounts are not where our inheritance lie, and that there is no wisdom or growth beyond or further than Jesus, but he is all in all, and every truth is an echo of him, and all wisdom is a heartbeat of his own life, that which pumps in his veins. So, I'm a 24-year-old youth pastor. So if you know anything about me, I'm a 24-year-old youth pastor whose dad planted a church on his own. If you know anything about me, you know I don't know much about inheritances or money. That much is clear. But what I know and what you know can be clearly and easily shared between us. And it is probably the best way to end our time together this morning. This is what we all know. We know that the realest thing about us is not the value of our stuff, but the loving hand that from the heavens clings to us. We all know that that hand, Jesus' hand, is here waiting for us to reach out to him in faith through the dark mystery of his own love. We know how easy it is to say yes to any number of idolatries, and we know the ones that have a hold on our own lives. We know how lonely that life can be. We all know that Mary had to have sat constantly at her Lord's feet before she ever praised this vitally, hoped with this conviction. And we know that we can sit with that same Lord today. And we know, whether by creed or intuition, memory or conviction, that the good stuff of life is actually found in putting away the selfish habits that we have learned to justify and love, and instead living in those lingering, literal, tangible moments whereby we reach out, whether by word or deed, silence or in public, with all our heart, mind, soul, and strength, for the hand that always seems to meet us in the strangest, weirdest ways, drawing from our lips something like this: you are my chosen portion, my cup, you hold my lot, the lines have fallen for me in pleasant places. Indeed, I have found him, the good portion, Jesus, my inheritance. Pray with me. Jesus, you're here with us, which is insane in its own right. Help us as we sing now, as we pray, as we leave, as we speak to one another, as we look into the eyes of those who are literal, tangible miracles, as we go home to our families or alone, to the old joys, to the old loves, to the old sins, old idolatries that will all meet us there. Help us to know that you are the good stuff, the one thing we could not go without. Help us to choose you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Stand.
Oh,
Father of all mercies.
May the God whose power was at work in the resurrection of Jesus establish the fruit of your praise, give you life and peace and joy as you go. Go in peace.